church. This is incredible.
Rumors have it.
Hold the Line podcast. I'm so honored to be here. You are such a legend, a hero. You've stood up for, you know, the word of God. You've stood up for the church. You've just been such a light in this season, in a lot of seasons. But thank you. Thank you for being who you are.
No, thank you for being you. I mean, what you did, and I've written about this, talked about it privately, offline and online. The September, or the Sacramento gathering, that initiated the pushback.
Yeah.
I mean, who would do this in the midst of a pandemic, gather thousands? How many showed up in Sacramento?
Close to 12,000.
So we're in the capital of the most restricted state during COVID. And the Spirit of God empowers you. You begin to have these events, these gatherings. But you have the audacity to gather in the capital of California. And close to 12,000 people show up. And just unbelievable. And I remember, I know this is like offline from your agenda here, but the attempt by the enemy to say, out of this will come this massive spreading of, never happened. There was a divine hedge of protection. Yeah. There was never any sort of a wow, you know, it was a spreader?
Yeah, super spreader.
Super spreader. Yeah. It was a super Holy Ghost infused event that ignited the church to say no.
Come on.
So grateful to you. I mean, again, your courage, you're Gideon, buddy.
Thank
I congratulate you. I commend you. I applaud
Well,
you.
I was thinking about that event last night because we were in Fairfield, and we just celebrated a year. You know, we're on the Golden Gate Bridge on Friday.
Yeah.
And we were in Fairfield last night. It was 107 degrees. And that night when we started in Sacramento, it was my wife was driving down from Redding. She pulled into Sacramento. It was 111 degrees and smoky. And she's like, she called me. She's like, babe, I don't know if anyone's going to come. And I was like, I don't know either, but we're on here on stage and our gear's frying. And so that moment to me, and I'm so grateful you were there and you were such a champion and you brought your whole church and it was amazing. It gave me such hope for California. You know, I was coming out of the, you know, running on the congressional race and felt like such a failure. And then I'm like, maybe I should leave California. Then this thing happens. Then all those people show up and that video went viral. You know, the video of us, of everybody jumping up and down and dancing and worshiping, because all of America, no one knew out of California something like that could take place.
In the midst of a pandemic.
In the midst of a
pandemic. With great uber unrestricted governmental totalitarian restrictions.
Right.
Who does that?
Insane.
The pushback on the Capitol steps, baby.
And you know, it's incredible. Now we're kind of on the other side of that, but the church has some grit, is raw, is fiery. Let's just start out by saying this. What would be your encouragement? Have you seen post-pandemic that's different in the church than pre-pandemic?
It includes the movement that you're currently leading. It includes a multi-generational dynamic of we're not going back to the old normal.
Yeah.
If this is the new normal, what does the new normal look like? Well, it's definitely not the old wineskin. There's a new wineskin, a new infrastructure, a new delivery mechanism that is being created by the Spirit of God through obedient men and women who are adhering, who are not conforming to this world, Romans 12:2, or not quenching the Holy Spirit. That group of modern-day Nazarites, you're one of them. You're a modern-day Nazarite. From your hair to your dietary preferences. Did I just say
I
that?
Meat.
He eats meat. No, but it's that sort of modern-day Christ redemptive, you know, a New Testament, New Covenant reality. That's what I sense. Like, enough with the old, man. We're living in cuckoo for Cocoa Puff times. This is not what it used to be.
Right.
And we discovered during COVID a number of things. One, a very large segment of the church, unfortunately, is willing to drink the Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
We discovered that the church is like, if Uncle Sam says, you know, sit down, it's basically Simon Says. Even if it runs counter to our Judeo-Christian value system, the word of God or the Spirit of God, we're going to surrender. We can't. So what I see now is just a group of amazing young men and women who are saying, absolutely not. We will not conform to this world. We will not quench the Holy Spirit, and we're not going to drink the Kool-Aid. That's what you're leading, and for such a time as this, here we are.
Man, I love that. I was, you know, preaching this morning at a church, and just the kind of the return to the Book of Acts, and how, you know, heaven sanctioned two jailbreaks, and after in Acts 4, after, you know, John and Peter got in trouble, they went back to a prayer meeting and asked for more boldness so they can get in more trouble, and you have this this thing where this kind of this false perception of what Romans 13 means, how it applies. We've gone after that in this podcast in other ways, but in the midst of that you have this church that now we're waking up and realizing, oh wait a sec, like God actually one of his first miracles was coming into the temple with a whip. You know, he had this intensity, this tenacity to wake people up, to get people to arise. How do you see that playing in that Book of Acts dynamic right now across America?
Yeah, it's an infusion of the Spirit of God prompting Acts 2:14, Pentecost, and Peter stood up and raised his voice. So it's powerful. Spirit of God descends. People listen to God's word, the gospel preached, in their own respective language. So it's an issue of ethnic and cultural unity, where they hear the language of the Spirit. And then subsequently, you have this prophetic emergence of Peter standing up and raising his voice. That's what we're seeing. It's right now the church standing up, raising our voices. This runs counter to the idea of nominal, marginalized, silent, complacent, comfortable Christianity.
Yeah.
Kumbaya Christianity is officially over. It died during COVID.
Yeah.
And if you're not completely awake, talk about being the woke culture, the church is actually, you know, the true bearers of the woke ideology in its redemptive form, not in its, you know, dark form that we're currently seeing. And it's that, the Spirit of God igniting people to stand up, you know, raise your voice, stand up, go ahead. And what comes out of our mouth is that Joe message, a multi-generational message telling people, watch, God's not done with us yet.
Well, and it's amazing. I was thinking about how, you know, in this season, that you know, a lot of the Barna research is showing and suggesting that maybe at the most 60% of the church will return. Now, you and I have been in California. We've been in the most restricted state. We've been fighting. You've been fighting. You've been at the forefront for churches to open. I have seen all my friends that have opened and taken a step of boldness. Dude, their churches are blown up. People, on the other hand, that kind of sat back, they're having a harder time. Is that something you've seen as well?
With great due deference, and Pastor Jeff can attest to this, and I say this with humility, it's the grace of God, hashtag best year ever. We've never had, this is our biggest growth year.
Wow.
We've seen so many people, because we stayed open, as you well know, and it wasn't about being defiant to government.
Right.
It's about the essential, this church being essential. It's about you can't discriminate. You can't tell me liquor stores are important, but churches are not.
Strip clubs.
You can't say Jack Daniels, yes, Jesus, no. Casinos and strip clubs, you know, and cannabis, you know, dispensaries are important, but the church is not.
Right.
No.
Right.
I'm not going to drink your Kool-Aid.
Right.
And I'm not going to listen to everything Uncle Sam says. No, we don't sacrifice truth on the altar of political expediency.
Right.
We're not going to do that. We're the church, man.
Right.
We are the church. So I am seeing the same similarity across the board in America and across California and across America, churches that have stayed open and have, were committed to providing services and ministry and to be light in the midst of darkness are thriving. I just, this 60% from Barna, I do believe that we're at the precipice. We get this right, we're going to see an awakening. We're going to see more people come to Jesus than ever before in human history.
Come on.
There's an awakening coming.
I believe it.
And this awakening is going to be pretty amazing and powerful. I love it. Every single time you write the church off, go for it. I mean, you know, it's you name it. Get Lenin, you know, communism will outlast Christianity. Yeah. The Third Reich, you know, the Third Reich, Joseph Goebbels will outlast Christianity. The Beatles, we're going to get more adoration of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit combined. Lenin is dead, Nazis are gone, the Beatles don't exist, but here we are.
Right.
So everyone who has ever written off the church, good luck with that.
We're
2,000 years, baby, we're still around.
and we've worshipped through a lot worse situations, you know, in history. I was coming in your church today as people were entering out, I was realizing, you know, you pastor a very multi-ethnic, multicultural, a lot of different colors, a lot of different backgrounds. How have you navigated this season where it's been politically divisive? This is going to lead into the politics portion of what we want to talk about. How have you navigated that with COVID? Because COVID's been political.
COVID's been political.
It's been weaponized. Of course, the election, all the crazy stuff. How has that been for you?
Yeah, we pastor what some have described outside this church as arguably the most multi-ethnically diverse church in Sacramento County. So we don't even know. Our numbers are 40% white, 40% black, 20% Latino and Asian. Any given Sunday, you can't tell the majority group. Today, this place was packed, and you have no idea who was who, right? And it's just God's harvest, God's people. We look like the kingdom of heaven, and we are intentionally, there's an intentionality behind our multi-ethnic diversity. We want to look like the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah.
So this past year and a half has been the most difficult year ever for the history of this church because of politics, because of COVID, because I speak really fast because I've had two Starbucks today. So because of all of this, it's critical for you to be cognizant of this. We've been through a process. I can't lie to you and tell you it wasn't difficult. No, it was difficult.
Yeah.
Were there moments of tension? Undoubtedly.
Right.
Both the COVID dynamic, the staying open, and then the political dynamic at the end. What we saw was if we stick to principle, if we don't sacrifice truth on the altar of political or cultural expediency, if we are committed to the centrality of Christ in advancing the kingdom of heaven, he'll take care of this. And he did. And he absolutely did. So it's about the Lamb's agenda. In this church we teach we're not Republicans or Democrats. We are Christians first and foremost. And we're not about the donkey or the elephant. We're committed fully to the Lamb's agenda. That Lamb's agenda is 110% pro-life.
Right.
110% pro-religious liberty and 110% pro-biblical justice.
Yeah.
Biblical justice.
Yeah.
That's what we teach here. Once we came in agreement to that, everybody said, I'm all in. So that's how we do it here. So we don't shy away from addressing issues that need to be addressed with a biblical impetus. We do it with truth and love. We're a Psalms 89:14 church. Righteousness and justice, truth and love. These are the four values that guide us.
So let's go a little bit deeper. So that's kind of been your situation in the last season. Now, God has placed you in just unique places. I was checking out your Wikipedia page. Need to update it a little bit.
Needs to be updated there.
Needs to be updated. Yeah. Whoever's over that. But you having a voice in the Obama administration, did you open prayer for that inauguration? What was something you
so
did?
So I was there for Bush 4 years. For President Obama, for his inauguration 2008, I did his St. John's Episcopal Church morning service, and I was a part of the program. Myself, T.D. Jakes, Yolanda Adams, and Rick Warren. And then, 8 years later, President Trump invited me, and I prayed at the inauguration on the big stage. So there's a morning service at St. John's Episcopal Church that's private, the family, senators, congressmen. And then there is the one that the whole world sees. So I've done it for both administrations, different levels and so forth. And I've served three presidents thus far in some sort of advisory capacity.
Okay. So how has that advisory capacity, because people talk about Daniel, they talk about, being a voice to the king, even when you don't agree with them.
Yeah,
you've straddled that line. I know where you stand. I know what you believe in, but walk us through a little bit of that journey, even over, because right now, and I feel like as long as I've been alive, this is the most divisive political season I've experienced.
Never been down this road before, at least in our respective generations, but even in American history, the level of discord, division, strife, partisanship, it's truly unprecedented. And even historians have argued, this you would have to go back to the Civil War to see this sort of angst and tension.
Well, and it really hit home for me because, I didn't ever wanted to be in politics, honestly, and I had this word of the Lord to run for Congress, and I just thought in my mind, like, okay, all the prayer meetings I've been at the call with Lou, you were at a lot of those, praying for the unborn, praying for God would raise up righteous judges, pray that the death decree would be overturned, praying for all these things. And I just like, man, I'm going to activate these prayers and like stand up and go for it, right? I had this assumption that the church would get behind me. Like, I just thought, this is very simple. Like, I'm not this crazy white ring fanatic. Like, I'm literally like a Bible guy. I'm a missionary. And I just believe in these core things. And in California, it's easy to tell the difference out of all states, right?
Right.
Man, I was so shocked. I could not believe that that one decision would literally blow my life up, blow my relationships up. The whole worship community, everybody's just scared, don't want to touch it, don't want to deal with it. To me, it was very, very divisive, and I did not expect that here in California.
It's the unfortunate reality that if you are fully committed to advancing a kingdom agenda of righteousness and justice, there will be blowback, and I don't mean external, internally. It's the Apostle Paul writing, hey, to my spiritual sons and daughters, primarily to my sons, and talking, hey, dear Timothy, Listen, let me give you a word of advice. Not everyone is going to be, you know, lined up with us, even within those that are following Jesus. So even within the church, there is discord and strife. And what drives them? It's fear. It really is fear. Fear of losing followers. Fear of hindering your influence. Listen, I do believe a generation must rise up where integrity must be much more important than influence, where the anointing is greater than the ambition. The moment we get this right, then we're going to see a revival and awakening. But it requires, like, the church should come together and support candidates that are advancing righteousness and justice, truth and love. I still have great issues. I have great qualms with Christians that pray righteousness and justice on Sunday and vote for an agenda that runs counter to what they prayed for on Sunday. That lack of continuity is the reason why this nation is going to hell in a handbasket.
Oh, 100%. And so how did you become an advisor to two of the most politically, different in a lot of people's minds? Let's just take Obama and Trump.
Okay.
Take those two, for example. Walk us through that journey.
It's a God thing. I mean, when I was 14 years old in an Assembly of God church in Allentown, Pennsylvania, the Teen Challenge choir director named Bernie walked in there, never met the guy before in my entire life. His name's Bernie, really is. It really is Bernie. You know Bernie?
Bernie
walks in there, and I just met Bernie this year, so I didn't know his name till this year. Cool story of something that happened at a Harrisburg church, and just great encounter. So I finally found out who he was this year. But he goes in there, and I'm a kid. I'm 13, 14 years old, and he stops the song, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Midstream, he cuts it. I'm interrupting the song because the Holy Spirit is telling me there's a Sammy, a young Sammy in this church. I'm the only Sammy. Church points to me, pastor says, there's only one Sammy, there he is. So they bring me up, I'm like, oh God, if there's a rapture, like these guys actually teach, let it happen right now, right? And the guy calls me and says, you're gonna pray over, the Lord says, you're gonna pray and speak to President of the United States of America. 14. My mom was there, my church was there, my future wife, bride was there. She heard the whole thing.
That's crazy.
Yeah, I'm 14 years old, boom, laid it out. So when Obama brought me in, it was a God thing. When Trump brought me in, so it's not Sam. I never knocked on the door. I never said, I want to meet with the president. Or like, who writes a letter? I want to advise you. You know, no one does. So it was a God thing. Ordained by God, sustained by God. So I knew it. There are presidents that, for sake of ethical polity, I will not reference whether or not I supported them. But it's kind of obvious via my convictions, right? There are presidents that I advise that I never voted for. And they knew it. And that's why they had me advising them. They wanted a contrary voice or a voice. One of the great exchanges I had with the Obama administration was when the Supreme Court ruled in favor of redefining traditional marriage. Yeah. And I did an op-ed piece. I think it was Fox News or Wall Street Journal. I forget. And I think pretty sure it was Fox News. And I get a letter, an email from the Obama White House congratulating me on my disagreement. And that's like that's the one I'm giving to my, I have a bunch of stuff, but that's the one I'm giving to my grandkids. Because the wording was, you completely disagreed with the president's position, the Supreme Court decision, but you did it in such a way that we wish and we would pray that this is the model that Christians should engage. And it, my eyes swelled up because I went like, yeah, there it is. So you could disagree with someone and do it in such a truthful yet loving way where you're not sacrificing your convictions and principles, but there's an anointing of grace, whimsical, nuanced, anointed, not politically correct, just truth with love. Daniel would just disagree with the policies of the kings, and yet they continue to bring him in. I mean, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I'm burning you guys up. They disagreed, and yet, all right, I'm promoting you. It happens. We can do this. We can speak truth to power with love in a way that it compels people to go like, man, I disagree with you, but I can't deny the Spirit of God inside of you.
Man, that is powerful.
Yeah.
That's a very amazing story. So, and then did you feel, so how do you push back against, because obviously you represent, you know, the Latino voice, you represent believers. How do you stand in that place knowing that there even may be agendas on their side to try to position you for their favor? How does that?
This
is my own personal question.
You know, it's a matter of integrity. Integrity is everything. So you have to go in there with principle. Like, what drives me? You know, am I here to lift up my vertical or my horizontal voice first and foremost? Mm-hmm. So I am a Christian.
Yeah.
I'm an American.
Yeah.
In that order of Latino Hispanic descent. So that's the pecking order.
Right.
So when I would go into the White House, the agenda items that would emerge, if they were contextualized around ethnicity or whatever groups, you, however you want to deem them, then I would have to put on that hat, but with that rubric in line.
Right.
So I'm first and foremost a Christian. So with that agenda item for what it like immigration reform.
Right.
Immigration reform popped up. It seems like it's a left liberal agenda item, but it isn't. It's a biblical item that can be addressed with a biblical worldview.
Right.
It's not left or right. So I addressed it from a biblical worldview, reconciling Leviticus with Matthew. So it's Matthew 25, Leviticus 19, and you reconcile both and boom, you have a solution. So I laid it out for them. And I gave this to Obama, I gave it to Bush, and then I gave it to President Trump literally over dinner. So you provide a solution that works for the greater good, but
right.
always the kingdom. Your vertical must lead your horizontal.
Yeah.
You're never, so in the Latino community, for example, I tell my Latino pastors, if we make immigration more important than pro-life, God will never bless it. He can't. It's out of alignment with scripture.
Wow.
Let the Latino church emerge as the most pro-life community and God will take care of the immigration
Come
issue.
On.
Guess who's
Come
the most
on.
Pro-life community, according to Pew Research, in America, even more than white evangelicals from Redding, California? Guess.
Come on.
The Latino community.
Come on.
The most pro-life community
That's
in
crazy.
The great U.S. of A. Do your due diligence
That's
with Barna
crazy.
And Pew. So it works. If we get our vertical right, he'll
right.
take care of our horizontal.
Well, and what's interesting, I just had a conversation with one of the leading poll guys right now in America, and he called me the other day. And
By
he's
poll,
like,
you mean like Polish, or do you mean
No,
what?
Like
polling. Sorry, got
Sorry,
that one wrong.
Not Polish.
I'm just
like
asking.
The guys that,
that
run polls. No, good.
Right?
Thank you for thank you for clearing that up. No. And he was telling me as they were running these national polls, what they could not believe is that the Latino Hispanic community, by and large, is agreeing with the conservative view of immigration. Like it's shifted.
Oh, yeah.
You know, massively
sure,
right now.
You know, Latinos don't want illegal immigration, man. That's like hype from like media that's committed to one worldview. It's not legitimate. We
yeah.
live in a world full of lies.
Yeah.
And it's hard to distinguish. That's why we have to be light so we can deliver the truth with authority, and that truth will bear fruit if it's done with love, because it's a lie. The idea that Latinos want open borders, untrue.
Right.
Latinos want illegal immigration. Untrue. Every single survey, we want people to come here legally.
Right.
We believe immigrants yeah. are a blessing if they come here legally.
Such a blessing.
We even believe immigrants are going to be like a great tool for revival.
Oh, 100%.
Like who's like
totally
Assemblies of God, Church of God,
right.
Baptist, Foursquare. The, mm-hmm. the leading growth is from the Latino
yes.
church planting movement, right? So indeed. So we love the immigrant community. We want people here to come legally, and we are against illegal immigration. That's the belief of the majority of Latinos. So it's not complicated.
Yeah.
It's just media attempting
well,
to frame a narrative.
Well, yeah, and that's something that I discovered, you know, having gone to 110 cities now in the last year. You know, I mean, in the beginning of this thing, you know, we the people the fighters that I could find that would roll with me, they were not. And to be honest, I'm my own process with this. They were not the white evangelicals. They were not the prophetic. River communities, which I know really well,
right.
they were not the ones standing up. I had to find this, like, for example, when I went to Portland, it was the Russian community
yes.
that said, we'll show up in downtown Portland, we'll bring sound gear, we'll bring video stuff, we'll capture it. And I said, well, why are you guys willing to do this? No one else is going to do it. And they said, because we refuse to let this place become like the place we left.
I recently gave a word to the Slavic community. God has supernaturally enabled me and enamored me with the Slavic community. And that's the word God gave me, the fact that they survived, you mm-hmm. know, the Soviet regime, the communist ideology, that they came out of the Baltic states and
right.
Russia, Ukraine, et cetera, and now here they're in America. The Slavic community must emerge along with other immigrant groups as
right.
the firewall against socialism, communism, Marxist ideology that is completely
yeah.
antithetical to a Christian worldview.
Right. And how would you encourage, and let's take this just a couple more things, but let's talk about the indoctrination.
I want to say one time. The Hispanic American community, the Latino community, especially Latino Christians, are, who are we? We are the vaccine against the virus of socialism in America.
Ooh.
That's who we are.
Tweet that.
We
vaccine
are the,
against
we are the vaccine.
I love that.
We are the vaccine because we know Venezuela. We know Cuba.
Right.
We know Bolivia.
Right.
We know Nicaragua.
Right.
We know what takes
it's
place.
Never
we,
worked.
No, it's right now.
It's
People
never
are
worked.
Literally dying in Venezuela because they don't have enough food.
Yeah.
Of malnourishment.
So how is it that white, woke, even Christians are so enamored with this concept? I mean, is it based in the posture of ungratefulness? Is it based in the posture, like, what is the thing? I don't understand that. Where's the dots?
It's idolatry. It's idolatry of race. This whole conversation we're having in America, it's about racial idolatry. We're worshiping race. Where right. Race is God. And the color of your skin is your quintessential descriptor. Not biblical, by the way.
Right.
Not true. We right. celebrate diversity of color. God, the mosaic of Revelation, all right. the colors, right. all the creeds, worshiping the Lamb on the throne. We love it. However, it's not the color of your skin, the pigmentation or lack thereof that defines you. Right. It's the Spirit of God inside of you. It's a relationship with Jesus. It's your Christianity.
Yeah.
And we have these woke individuals that are primarily, you said it, not I, you mentioned it's white leftists and white woke and even some in the church, right?
Right.
If you ever talk about the conversation of white privilege, that's white privilege. White privilege is not if you're born white, you know, you're automatically a racist. That's a lie from the pit of hell. The idea that we're trying to teach people and young boys and girls in school that if you're born of a certain skin color, you're already of a default, you're a
right.
racist.
Critical.
That's
CRT,
that's
yeah.
diabolical from the
right.
pit of hell.
Totally.
Imagine that. But it's just a liberal mindset, but it's primarily from, unfortunately, white individuals who want to continue to place Sam Rodriguez as a Latino and African Americans in the camp of perpetual victimization.
Right.
They make money off that. They get elected off that. They get
right.
power if they convince me I'm a victim. I am no one's victim. I am more than a conqueror. I'm not a whiner. I'm a worshiper.
Come on.
So I'm not anyone's victim. I'm a child of God. And that's the reality.
Man, that is powerful. No, I feel like it's so destabilizing and crippling for people when they buy into that.
And one of the most beautiful, unbelievable, beautiful communities in the world is the African-American community, especially in America, in this nation. The African-American community is so productive, so fruitful. I'm a student. I have a minor in Black history of the Harlem Renaissance. Creativity, innovation,
wow.
brilliance, just brilliance. I want, and my daughter is marrying an African-American next year.
Come on.
And so this is a community that I live to reconcile. Billy Graham's message, Dr. King's March. Man, I'm trying to get African-Americans and Latinos who are beautiful. White people are beautiful. I just said it. Asians are beautiful. We must push back on this idea of perpetual victimization. It's a lie from the pit of hell. They want people. It's the Egypt mentality, making
right.
bricks about straw. It's Pharaoh's message of survive. You need Uncle Sam to survive. You're a victim. You're a minority group. Don't even call me a minority because I don't call myself a minority. I don't even know what that means. Minority of what?
Right.
What does that mean? Well, I mean, the whole minority nomenclature, government assignment, you know, I hate it. I push back on it. I'm an American.
Yeah.
Knock it off. Above
right.
all things, I'm a Christian. But my objective in my
yeah.
life is to push back on this ideology and reconcile Billy Graham's message with Dr. King's march and push back on perpetual victimization for generations to come.
Come on, I love that. I have one last question. That's a lot of fire. I hope you guys are getting
a lot of speak.
I hope you
you're going to get some pushback on the podcast. Boy, does that boy ever speak fast.
Well, that's what happens after you do three services and you're
just
surviving
three services and it's like,
on
yeah,
coffee
well, yeah,
and
green tea.
So, I released this thing after Biden was elected, you know, how to pray for the Biden administration, and I set out some bullet points, and was posted around, and it was good. It was just a little bit of a map, you know, for how do we approach the
season.
So
you do pray for President Biden?
I do.
No, I mean, that's cool.
Yeah.
Like, the idea would be, like, why should Christians, you know, President Biden is not pro-life, not
right.
pro-religious
right.
liberty, and his, you know, his definition of justice runs counter to the biblical
yeah.
outline of
right.
justice. So it's great that you have the bandwidth and the biblical maturity enough to encourage people to pray.
Well, I think it's important for us. And I think that it truly is. You can't really get God's heart if you're not praying, you know, like
yeah.
you can't, you know, because we all have our ideas, our thoughts or whatever. But I'm like, man, I want to know, God, your heart in this situation. So, but it's been a lot of months since then. There's been a lot of things that have changed. And part of my prayer was, God, just change his heart and over these specific things. Well, what we've seen in the last several months has been by far the most left crazy agenda in a lot of ways, right?
Right, right.
And it's hurting Americans. I mean, I just paid $5 and 60 cents a gallon or something for gas. Right. Not just on the major issues that I care about, but even the, you know,
economic issues. Right.
What is your encouragement as we face the next 2.5 years of this?
Right.
3 years of this.
So, you know, you do a comparative analysis. You could, because you always go back to, you know, President Trump, President Bush, President Obama. There are certain presidents that had character issues that you prayed about, and then some had policy issues. And then some had both character and policy issues, right, that you had to pray about. So every president is flawed. However, there are policies that are have egregious multi-generational consequences. Mm-hmm. So a president's character and issues, like with President Trump, the issue about his tweets and all that, right? And,
yeah.
and some of his, you know, outbursts and so forth, which I did not support every tweet and every outburst.
Right, right.
But his policies were more in alignment
right.
with that threefold agenda I laid out previously. We need to pray, intercede, but we need to get every Christian to, in the midterm election, to vote life, religious liberty,
right.
and biblical
yeah.
justice.
Yeah.
And then when it comes in 2024, we must line up and
yeah.
vote that agenda.
Yeah.
Again, this is black, white, Latino, and Asian. I would love every Christian to jump on the independent bandwagon
yeah.
and vote 100% pro-life, religious liberty, biblical justice.
I like that
so
idea.
You're not deemed as
yeah.
You're a Republican operative. You're a Democrat. Again, I advise three different presidents, different, you know, parties, right?
Right.
And so, again, do that. It's the only way
yeah.
we can continue to stay together
yeah.
and yet advance, because the consequences are serious.
They are.
Think about what we're doing
yeah.
now. Abortion beyond the 9th month. The government telling me what I can preach about, you know, and even this governor here in California, I wasn't allowed to worship technically in my home.
Right.
I mean, who says that?
Yeah.
You can't meet
totally.
With your family, a group of people, and open and sing, chant. Did he say that? He did.
Yeah.
You're kidding me. Well, you know, we have French Laundry. So you just can't.
Right.
There has to be, and I hope the church rises up and
yeah.
goes like, you know what? This is serious.
Yeah.
If we don't stand up, will our children and our children's children, if the Lord tarries, hear the gospel?
Right.
What we do in our generation will determine whether or not the next generation will hear the gospel of Jesus
Come
preached.
On. And I believe 2022, there's a reckoning. There's a reckoning coming in the midterm elections. I think that we're going to see Christians rise up like never before. Okay. What does hold the line mean to you?
Hold the line means that. It means literally standing up, stop drinking the Kool-Aid. Acts chapter 2:14, Peter stood up and raised his voice. You know, stop drinking the Kool-Aid. No
Come
more
on.
Kumbaya Christianity. Defend our Judeo-Christian value system with truth and love. Hold the line. Stop drinking the Kool-Aid. Don't conform to this world. Don't quench the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you so much.